What's going on, y'all? This is Darrion Gray, the Out of Bounds podcast, a TSU Herald sports one. And let's do a quick little roll call for y'all real quick. Ladies first, Mickey B, not Mickey D's. What's happening?
What's up?
Tia J, what's good with you?
Hey, what's up?
Now for my fellas, Pedro.
What's up, man?
You good?
Yeah, I'm good.
Dave, you got the sauce, folks?
Hey, you already know, you know what I'm saying? We dripping, never slipping over here, you feel me?
And I've already introduced myself. We got a videographer, the chief. Brandon, what's going on? You good over there too?
I'm doing well.
So here we're about to talk about a little bit of TSU sports. And the first thing we're going to jump into is the main attraction of the spring semester, the basketball season. Now, how y'all feeling about the basketball team, the men's team? Let's start off with the men's team.
Well, the men's basketball, I don't even know where to start. I mean, they've been really pretty much dominating, you know, SWAC this past month, if not month and a half. TSU is the leading scoring team in SWAC right now, averaging 78 points. They're on a 8th Street win. It started at Mississippi Valley, so they are dominating.
Well, it's very good. I mean, they've been led by Jeremy Combs, the senior from Dallas. I mean, he's been scoring 16.8 points per game for the entire year. Yeah. And
he's a graduate.
Yeah, and he's a graduate, and it might be his last year, but up from the latest game against Mississippi Valley State, he scored 24 points and 10 rebounds, and it makes for another double-double. So,
and can't forget, he's been SWAC, main SWAC player 4 times in a row. I never heard about that before. So he's bringing a lot of, you know, attention to TSU. He also secured his career high of 33 points and had 17 rebounds to go along with that, I think, against Jackson State. So he's, like, really – and then he also got another, award. Where is it? It's the Lou Henson Award nationally, national award. So he's, like, killing it.
Yeah, his trophy shelf is looking
nice.
He's
been very good. I mean,
hard work.
I mean, if I have to say, I mean, there has to be a source for his spectacular play. I mean, if I have to call it, then I just have to say it has to be the hair. I mean, his hair. I bet his hair has been has been giving him power for a lot of power. So
the
like,
powers
yeah.
and the
yeah.
dreads.
It has to be.
I mean, that
like
has to be the reason why he's been playing so well.
No.
I have to say, no doubt.
I heard he had that signature hairstyle since high school. Cause I know a couple people went to high school with him. He went to Carter. Yeah, they said he's had that since high school. So, and he's been doing good everywhere he's went, UNC. So yeah. It might be that you might have some right there, Pedro. I ain't gonna lie to you.
Yeah, like his first 3 years in college, he started in North Texas. And then in 2017, 2018, he moved to LSU. That didn't work out. He only played like 6 games. But entering for this year, he switched over to TSU. And that's where he's finally found his footing.
He's got a lot of playing time, too, with TSU.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Yeah, he followed his coach, head coach now, Johnny Jones, because he used to coach at LSU too. Also, Jalen Patterson, I believe, was from LSU.
Mm-hmm.
So he brought 2 players here, and they're really showing out. Speaking of Jalen Patterson, he missed two of the first games of their current winning streak right now, but he's back in the lineup, and he's really, you know, playing hard. Also, Eden Ewan is a good, you know, player. He's been averaging a double-double. So he's been getting double-doubles the last few games. He averages 13.8 points and 10 rebounds a game. So that's really good.
And before we transition off of men's basketball, we can't forget to mention the fact that, A, John Jones has been holding down the perimeter shooting for the team. Definitely been the best three-point shooter while Patterson was gone. And he's done a wonderful job at least keeping the defense honest and not being able to just be in the paint and play cones. But also, let's not forget, big fella did return last game. Everybody went wondering where 5 at.
Yeah, he added 10 points and 8 rebounds in his first game back, so that's really good.
Yep. He was a presence in the paint, so that 7-foot figure, I mean, he intimidates people that size, so look out for him along with the rest of the cast.
Look out for TSU basketball, period. Well, men's basketball, period.
And
March Madness coming up.
And speaking of which, watching out, it's not just the men. We got to watch out for the women's. We got a pretty good women's team, too.
Nice.
We got a pretty good women's team, too. let's not start off with double nine. Let's start off with some people they might not know. KK Turner. You know KK Turner, right. She returned from injury. Mm-hmm. A lot of people returned from injury. Right. Right around the right time. It's good. And KK provides a shot that I feel like has been missing from the team. You know? And basically, I think that her mid-range and her outside shooting sparks the rest of the team. I saw mm-hmm. it last game.
Some of the bigs that showed out in the game was Isis Lane. She came out with 10 rebounds. The whole team really out-rebounded Mississippi Valley, 50-26. So Isis Lane had 10 of those 50 rebounds for them.
Yeah, it was more than double. They doubled yeah. The total. Mm-hmm. Yep, 50-26.
Mm-hmm. And we was talking to Coach Hayes after the game about Isis. And she was mentioned about how Isis, sometimes she forgets to run the court. But when she does, it's impressive. Mm-hmm. And early in the game, not early, but right before halftime, Isis ended off with two, you know, important.
Fast breaks.
Yeah, I ain't gonna lie. You know, if y'all know Isis 6'3", you know, I ain't gonna lie, I might have been a little delusional.
What?
I thought she finna dunk. I ain't gonna lie.
She's
6'3"? She's 6'3". Every inch, too. I stood side by side.
Yeah.
Every inch.
Yeah.
She's 6'3". I said, oh, she finna dunk? Tough. But, but it was impressive. She had a steal, you know. I like Isis because of our big, she's probably the most mobile. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. Maybe from her track background as well because she also runs track for the team. Mm-hmm. And so she can move. She can move. We've seen it on the breakaway. You know, she had a really good game. She was hurt that she didn't get those two boards, though. She was very hurt. She wanted to. But it's okay.
But Coach said she got to get it in the top of the game, so if she wants to.
Now moving to...
Oh, and Markia Turner.
Yeah, KK.
She had a game high.
Yeah, she comes off the bench with a game high of 16 points and 4 rebounds.
Also five assists and 1 steal.
It was impressive. It was impressive. And everybody knows Nia Mitchell. She's been playing. She's been named to the top 5 by undefeated HBCU Female Hoopers of the Week. Mm-hmm. I think it's long overdue. I might have to call the undefeated and ask them, like, hey, have y'all not been to Houston, Texas?
Right.
It is one of the biggest cities in the nation.
Right.
Y'all must not have heard about this girl, Nia Mitchell, because she been putting on the show. Mm-hmm. Y'all just ain't been watching.
Baller.
I want to say if she doesn't average a double-double, she consistently gets them. So I want to say she's had 10 in swag play, 10 or 9 up there, and she lives in the paint. I told her. I said, what's the key? She's like, I'm hungry. I'm hungry.
That's how you got to say it.
And that hunger, she feeds in the paint. Mm-hmm. That's what she does. So I'm very impressed with her game. But moving off the court, and hopefully both teams are going to be facing Alabama State on Saturday. Hopefully they can continue their winning streaks. So, and just continue them to SWAC, because SWAC is coming soon. It's about time for the tournament. Mm-hmm. And I just want to see another trophy up, another banner dropped mm-hmm. in HBE.
Absolutely.
Because I don't know. I think I've seen 2, 3, maybe 4. I ain't got tired of them yet. I want to see a 5th and a 6th.
I want to keep going this thing.
Exactly. I might not graduate, so I can... I'm graduating.
Wait a minute.
Hey, I'm tripping.
Now, brother.
But, hey, let's move on to the soccer team who has a new addition that Ms. Tia J will be telling us about.
Okay. Our new coach named Lindsay Vera. A little bit about her. She started off playing showcases in Houston and got recruited to NC State on a full scholarship. She there finishes her career with 27 goals, later interning for youth club soccer teams. She then, after that, went to the University of Texas, Rio Grande Valley, where she assisted head coach Glad Brigero, that's his last name, and assisting him, they... in 2014, she helped bring the team NCAA Division I women's soccer to the region for the first time. And later after that, she goes to head coach at University of North Carolina, Asheville. And now she's here at us at TSU.
Welcome. Okay. Welcome. Say her name for me one more time.
Lindsay Vera.
Welcome, Coach Vera.
Welcome.
We appreciate y'all. We appreciate you. You know, we know you're gonna bring the mm-hmm. the staff that we need,
Dubs.
And we know we're gonna continue the success.
Mm-hmm. And that's how
you know,
we
TSU soccer. You know, they do pretty good for themselves.
They do.
So that's cool.
They get some dubs.
You know, so hey, Coach Bear, what you gonna do for us? We need to talk to Coach Bear. We need to talk to Coach Bear. I'm gonna set that up. Hey, T, you trying to go talk to him?
Yeah, we need
to. For sure. We gonna set that up after this. But speaking of, but on to the next one. And Dave has a little bit to talk to us about on a diamond, our former baseball specialist. You know what I'm saying? He used to be out there.
That's facts. All right, so, you know, coming off of a rough start for the baseball and softball team, you know, baseball got outscored by New Mexico State 62-14 in their first series. That's tough right there. But we're not going to speak on that. Bring it back.
Bounce back.
You feel me? We got our first dub. We upset Kansas, you feel me? The softball team, they got their first dub. So both of the teams, they're 1-7 right now. So, you know, all I have to say to the viewers is don't sleep, obviously, because the men's baseball team they've won the SWAC championship at least 3 years in a row. So don't sleep on them. You know, they just had a real start. That's how it is. The softball team, they just had a rough start. You feel me? They're going to bounce back. Don't even worry about it like that. So, yeah, that's my news on the softball baseball team.
And also got a new pitching coach this year, Aaron Gilbreth. I think that's how you pronounce his name. And he got hired fall of 2018.
So now, let me know.
That's pretty good.
Talk your talk.
From Northwestern Oklahoma State, where he, in 2018, the Rangers set a school record wins of as a Division II program with pitchers receiving all conference honors. So I just wanted to give a little background on him.
And we had the preseason pitcher of the year. What a coach with a legacy of great pitching.
Talk us out.
I know we won a 7 right now.
That's cool.
Do I look worried?
Yeah, you hear me?
No. come on now. I'm not worried. Softball been winning. Do I look worried?
No.
Come on now.
Tell him again.
All right, I'm not worried at all. I know about the you know, it's like the Patriots. All year. I heard about how Brady was falling off.
You hear me?
All year. It's not. Oh, man, they got rid of Garoppolo. This ain't the year.
Oh, yeah.
But sometimes you just got to have faith. Mm-hmm. I might not see it, but you got to have faith.
Mm-hmm.
Just like Brady and the Patriots.
Preach, Pastor.
Just like when everybody said the Patriots wasn't gonna do it, I said, you know what? I ain't gonna count them out.
Hallelujah.
Well, for me as a Texans fan, I counted them out.
And look where that got you. Hold on. I'm gonna say it right now.
Hold on.
I'm not a Texans fan, but
yeah, that's why I told
you. But I understand that. You count out the Patriots, so what the hell you doing? Looking silly. I ain't gonna look silly. Ain't no egg on my face. I'm gonna believe in my softball and my baseball team. I'm gonna rock with them till I can't rock no more.
Mm-hmm. I like how you switch back, though.
I
would talk about the NFL. I swear.
Nah, we here. We here. We appreciate our sports. We got some, you know, we got some good sports in there. Everybody just don't recognize.
Football coming up. We had a great recruiting season. So, and also a new head coach. What's his name? McKinney. Coach McKinney.
Yes, indeed.
So, yeah, I'm excited. We got a lot of transfers that are pretty good. I know Montel Parker. I think he's a wide receiver. And DeAndre Johnson. So, yeah, I'm excited for football season.
I don't know what the Chinese New Year say, but 2019, the year of the tiger. That's all I got to say.
Yeah.
Point blank, period.
Yes, sir.
Now, after this little intermission, we will be talking about our professional sports. I hope y'all will stay tuned with us. This has been Out of Bounds. And we're back with the professional sports. This is Out of Bounds. Just like I promised you, and we here with pretty much the same group, but unfortunately, Dave is not here to join us. But we have a new kid in class today. He go by Ill Will.
What's good with y'all, man? What's good? How y'all living today?
We straight.
Man, I know y'all straight. What's happening?
All right. We good. I like that energy. So, today on Professional Sports, we're going to talk about James Harden. Been in the headlines for, Houston.
That's my boy.
Oh, Houston. Houston.
We know.
Where can we start?
We're going to start with Harden and talking about his criticism of the ref and the fact that his streak has happened. We're going to move into Zion Williamson, the one and done rule, and then we're going to cap it off with Robert Kraft and his extracurricular activities, so to speak. So let's get into Harden first. How y'all feel about Harden talking to the, how y'all feel about Harden's streak ending? Let me ask y'all that.
Inevitable.
Harden,
I mean, that's
I'm sorry. You go ahead.
Speak on it, Houston.
Yeah, H-Town. What's
well,
up?
Harden is the best offensive player right now. He's been on his 30-point streak, just ended against the Atlantic Hawks, but Rockets still won, by the way. You know, because some people feel like he got to, score 30 points or more in order for the Rockets to win. But, I mean, we're a pretty good team, in my opinion. But his streak ended 32 games. Mm-hmm. He wasn't going to go. I don't think he was going to try to make it all the way to 65 games where he could have beat
Wilt Chamberlain.
Where he went all the way to 65 games in 1961 and 1962. So Harden is number two, second best longest streak in NBA history. Kemba Walker is number three with 23 games, and Stephen Curry is fourth place with 19 games.
Kemba, is that a current streak?
He was in 94-95.
Kemba Walker.
I mean, with Harden, what the rest of you guys said, I mean, it was inevitable for it to end. I mean, there's no way a player of today, like Harden, is able to keep this streak going all the way up until the end of the year.
Mm-hmm. And a player like Will that did do it, like at the time, it was in 1960s, he was probably only 7 footer in the thing, So for him to make that record and to catch Will, it was impossible.
I mean, if I remember correctly, he has like four different streaks of 30 plus.
Different.
Well, is that good?
He was
one season in
1960s, he was only playing against a whole bunch of, I don't want to, bring race into it, but a whole bunch of mainly white guys.
Speak your mind.
It wasn't really no talent out there. So, but I mean, I don't want to put, dim his light. He's still, a legend.
Hard to know. He had a lot of big shoes to fill.
He had a good run.
I wanted to mention James Harden averaged 43 points in January, and now his overall average is 36 points.
You got all the little Rocket stats, don't you? You got all the little Rocket stats.
That's my team.
You a super fan. I ain't mad at you. Know your team.
So hey, I admire that.
He gonna get it back.
That.
When's the next time he gonna score 30 points?
Probably next game. I mean, that's a norm for him.
For real?
That's crazy. I thought he might be able to do it.
Yeah, Harden, though, he has been in the news a lot lately. Of course, most recently, the situation with the referee, Robert Foster, of course. One game against the Los Angeles Lakers where the Lakers beat the Rockets 110-106. Harden and Chris Paul, they both complained about the referee, Robert Foster, which have a long, long-standing history with
him. He's really, he's really respected in the NBA. A lot of people feel like that was kind of the wrong move for Harden to do that because the Rockets are a contender, to go to the finals. So they, making bad relationships with, good referees is not a good thing.
But Robert Foster, though, I understand that players and referees need to have a good relationship. Mm-hmm. But Robert Foster, it ties a lot deeper. Just so happens, back in 2006 and 2007 season, the season that Tim Donaghy had that huge betting scandal, he made approximately 134 calls to Robert Foster during that time.
Wow.
But it said they didn't know, what the conversation was about, but it was part of the investigation.
Man, that's just
a question.
So
refs don't get fined or they don't get any type of consequence if they make bad calls?
That's tough because you really can't find a ref for messing up a judgment decision.
Yeah.
But
I'm always take it back to, I think it was the Warriors game. It was a game the Warriors, KD was out of bounds. And he threw the ball and they didn't say nothing.
And
then
you can
go back and see that the refs made a mistake. That's
just a tough part about the refs.
Sometimes not even want to watch basketball because, what's the point?
Look, you talking to the wrong guy about some messed up refs. I've lived that.
Yeah,
but
referees, it's
my question. My question, I'm sorry, apologies. My bad. But my question is, if I'm Harden, I ain't saying nothing to what many people consider to be the greatest contributor to my game, and that's the referees. So many people blame Harden, or not blame Harden, but blame the referees for Harden's streak continuing. The amount that he gets to the free throw line is crazy.
It's ridiculous.
And a lot of people, and I already know what you're going to say, Mick.
He's skilled.
You said what?
He's skilled.
I already knew it. I already knew that was coming. But at the end of the day, Harden does a lot. He gets a lot of calls that are also questionable. So with your finding thing, are we going to find him when they say things that, or when they make calls that benefit Harden? If so.
I mean, yeah. If you have a legitimate view that he made a mistake, if a referee made a, especially if it determined a win, like if it's a 1 point, 2 point, 3, 4, 5 points a game win, they need to go back and somebody needs to face the consequences of that, because either they need to redo the game or the referees need to be fined, because especially in championship, like the finals and the playoffs, it should be no type of mistakes going on.
Yes, but either way, how whatever you say about Harden, what and how many fouls he has from the refs, you still have to recognize how he's able to invite contact to his opponents for every play, and that prompts the referees to call him. And even if they're fouls or not, they still whistle them. And even though that. The opponent's fans and the opponents themselves, they'd get very, very angry about it. I mean, Harden is just doing what he's doing.
Unfortunately,
it takes a special skill like Harden, like to be able to draw fouls all the time and whatnot. It's very underappreciated in the sport, believe it or not.
Exactly. Yes.
I'm not a biggest fan. I think that he gets a lot of calls because of his name. Me personally, but unfortunately, you know, unfortunately, it doesn't matter why he gets them because he gets them. But on the collegiate level, unfortunately, Zion Williams, another star, has busted his shoe open.
Busted straight through the thing.
And
God,
I know what you wonder. Why do I care that a college student has a busted shoe? Because this has sparked the conversation of, should they even go to college in the first place? Should they be able to go one and done? Or should they lower the age
personally,
to 18?
Here's why I think about it. It's been talked about for years how, like, the one-and-done rule is tarnishing college basketball, is, you know, giving players, like, a cheap avenue to get to the NBA. But here's my thing. That game that Zion broke his shoe, Duke upped their tickets to $2,500 just to see him play.
Mm-hmm.
And do you know how much money Zion gets of it?
None.
Zero.
Well, I hate when y'all say that, because they do go to school for free, but they don't need to go to school, I guess.
But
at the same time... You're right. I don't know if they should get paid, though. Because
at least, like, have a choice to let them
brand their name. I think they should just go straight to the NBA, but I don't think they should get paid, because no other – if you put that in perspective, you'll start having to pay all athletes, college athletes. You know what I'm saying? So
yeah.
I think they should change that rule.
I feel like the main issue is just them marketing themselves. They don't have a chance to put their name out and market, because of how much money Zion is bringing in for Duke, or, heck, even all the players that came through Duke that bought the money in. Like, they brought so much revenue to the school, and they got none of it. So with this rule, like the NBA proposed recently, they proposed to lower the draft age from 19 to 18 years old, which will cause players to go back to high school. Well, go from high school to the NBA.
If they
and
please. You know, they choose to.
You said 18, 19 or
19? 19 to 18.
Yeah. And
yeah, they lowered the age.
And also they've made like an alternative for high school players that are coming out of high school and don't want to enter college. They made the G League.
Yeah.
And nobody's taking it.
Well,
I don't think anybody's taking it.
It's just
like,
it's
like,
in the beginning.
I don't think anybody chose
to
do the contract, though. It was $125,000, I want to say, in a year.
No, but
and
if I remember correctly, someone actually like accepted an offer to join the G League. I can't remember his name.
I could be wrong.
I think I know who you're talking about.
I could be wrong,
but
I think he backed out.
Yeah.
Last time I checked, I want to say there was nobody. But I could be wrong on that. But in my opinion... the AAU circuit is so great. You get to play with so many people around the world.
You get to travel.
Yeah, and you get to do all of that. For me, in my opinion, I like out of college. I say give them three. I say up the age. Everybody talking about lower the age. I understand Zion had
why up the age?
I'm about
though.
To tell you. Because at the end of the day, there is life past basketball. There's life past sports.
If it's life past sports, yeah, then leave college for the players that actually want to stay in school.
That's understandable.
Take the players that wants to make money and go to the league, allow them to go straight to
I understand that. I understand that. But if I can though people might not like it, if I have a kid and I say, look, you have to do this, that, and the third because I know later in life it's going to benefit you, I'm going to do that. Now, I understand that he can come get that fast money, but, I mean, long term, like, everybody can't be LeBron. Like, I understand some people come out. Like, Kwame Brown was terrible. You have people who, you know, there's a lot of people who unfortunately came out of high school, were really good in high school, didn't finish out. Maybe they could have went to college and maybe, you know, built up and developed.
But here's the beautiful thing about college, though. You can always come back and finish. John Wall, for example, while he hurt his Achilles injury, he's going back to get his degree. See, so it's not that, like, the players can't come back.
This is true that they can, but let's be real. You getting all that money right now, you probably not going back. Most of them don't for that reason. You get the money, you don't feel like you need to go back. But if you go and you go to college, now you can make money outside of it. That's just my personal feel. That's why I think three.
But they already making millions of dollars playing in the NBA.
You can blow it. In my opinion, you give them three, let them get an agent, and then let them make money while they're there. Give them 3 years. You can develop. A lot of players play three. Steph played three. Like, I understand that a lot of people come out of college. Dwayne Wade, who came out with LeBron, he didn't come straight out of high school.
Yeah,
a lot of players didn't go to high school.
It is good for players to go to college because sometimes they develop in college. A lot of players weren't ready to go straight to the NBA, but that's why it should be a choice. Some players are ready to go to the NBA. Like you said, we have Kobe?
Kobe, Bryant, LeBron, KG, Stoudemire.
You're naming people that went to college. We're not saying that you shouldn't, every player should go to the NBA. We're saying you should have a choice, in order, if you want to go to college or if you want to go to the NBA. They can go to college, they can get their degree, but especially if they're a top, one of the top best players, they're going to be making millions of dollars. What they going to get a degree in,
I don't like how you diminish an education though.
And even like D said,
if they blow through that, that's their problem. I mean,
yeah, and even like D said too, the opportunity is there to go back, but most players don't. That's the unfortunate part.
So let me pose y'all one question. I understand everything you're saying. What is the problem with the one and done? Why they can't wait 1 year?
Because it's a waste of time.
Why?
Why?
You get to compete with more people. Why is that?
You can get hurt
in the NBA.
Like I said before, if you're a star athlete walking around college campus and you see your jersey getting sold in there, you're not getting $1, how would you feel?
I understand that, but you're saying it's a waste of time. At the end of the day, playing athletics, I can get hurt playing rec ball. I can get hurt in practice. I can get hurt walking.
I mean,
doing anything.
I mean, ask John Wall. I mean, I remember, didn't he injure himself like at his house?
Yeah, that happened.
Yeah,
a lot of things.
Yeah.
Injuries
my
are.
My boy John Fall. My boy, though, he gonna bounce back.
I hate the argument that you can get hurt because you can get hurt doing anything at any moment. Injuries is a part of playing sports, and any athlete knows it. I understand you want to go get that quick bag, but I'm not against it.
It's just another thing. I believe Charles Barkley and Kenny and them, they're like saying athletes should, after their time in the NBA or NFL, whatever, athletes should be like trying to be a what's it called? Like, do their job, be a reporter, be an anchor. You know what I'm saying? I think they need to. They can always get skills. Pay for skills to become a good public speaker. I don't feel like they need to go to college because that's what most athletes are probably gonna do after their career is be like an anchor or something, a sports anchor, a sports commentator.